points about his career. He studied zoology in Pune and Mumbai universities. He did his PhD from Harvard University. There he became the first biology student to do PhD in mathematical modeling. As a researcher, his focus areas are ecology, natural resources, conservation, evolutionary biology, etc. So far, he has published over 200 scientific articles, research papers, along with 9 books. He has been a lecturer at Harvard, visiting fellow at Stanford, and distinguished Indo-US lecturer at UC Berkeley, and a faculty at IISc Bangalore. He has played an active role in conception and establishment of Ministry of Environment and Forest in 1981, conception of Forest Rights Act and Biodiversity Act. He also served on Science Advisory Council to Prime Minister of India and National Advisory Council, NAC. About the Gurus of Science lecture, the inaugural lecture of the Gurus of Science series was delivered by Nobel laureate Dr. Jeomari Lane. We have been having a privilege of listening to scientists and technical experts who are involved in scientific and technological research, frontier research in frontier areas. And as you're aware, that many distinguished lecturers, many distinguished Indian and foreign scientists have been a part of Gurus of Science lecture series. About the Western Ghats, it's one of the biodiversity hotspots and one of the 9 hottest biodiversity hotspots, along with Sri Lankan rainforests. The fragile and yet so critical ecosystem, it needs a tailor-made conservation solutions. These conservation solutions efforts are never against economic development, but it's rather a need of economical development, concept of economic development that needs to be a little bit matured so as to involve the ecosystem services that these ecosystems are providing. That's why we have an honor to listen to Dr. Gadgil, and directly over to him. Thanks.
It's my privilege to be here today and talk about the Western Ghats Ecology Expert Panel report, which, thanks to government's decision not to release it publicly, has attracted so much attention. It probably would not have if it had been promptly released. So it's, I think, really a great service to the cause of environment that the Ministry of Environment, which doesn't do too much for the cause of environment, has done in suppressing the report. Therefore, I have these opportunities, interesting opportunities from all segments of society as well as from all sides of political spectrum to talk about it. I think these are issues which really touch all of us. So what I want to highlight is actually what the report has to say, and perhaps some of the things I will rapidly go over. I would rather that we have more discussion. Western Ghats, of course, have attracted attention for a long time. Kalidasa, in his epic Raghuvamsha, the fourth sarga talks about the conquest of by Raghu Digvijaya of all four corners of India. And Raghu and his army as they pass over much of India is a graphic description. Perhaps the nicest stanzas are relating to the Western Ghats, where he likens the Western Ghats to a beautiful young maiden, as he says. Goa is her waist, the Nilagiris and Annamalais are her breast, the head lies at Agastyamala, so she's kind of reclining on her right hand side with the feet stretched up to Satpuras. We may call this Sayyachala as the maiden, and we are talking about this area, which from a number of perspectives has been at the focus of attention, particularly of those concerned with environmental issues. So these are the major hotspots of biodiversity world over that have been identified. And Western Ghats, along with the
Sri Lankan range, which really is a continuous region, has been identified as one of the more significant biodiversity areas of the world. There are a number of contexts in which this is of interest. One of them is this International Convention on Biological Diversity, now 20 years old or so. It makes very specific point that the states have sovereign rights over their biological resources, in particular those resources for which the nations are the country of origin. Now, as far as India is concerned, there are perhaps three parts of the country which are especially rich in biological resources: the Eastern Himalayas, the Andaman Nicobars, and Western Ghats. The Western Ghats are special in that the other areas, well, the Andaman Nicobars has relatively smaller number of species naturally given its small area. Eastern Himalayas is in a way richer. Nevertheless, it shares most of its species with China, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Bhutan, doesn't leave many which are exclusive to our country, whereas Western Ghats has a large number of species which are exclusive. This is related to the geological history of our continent. You might perhaps be aware that some time ago, this land where we are standing was part of the southern continent called Gondwana land. It was attached to Antarctica, Africa, South America, Madagascar. Then it broke apart and drifted. So this is the period when it broke off, this is geologically, and that is a period when the frogs and the reptiles, those groups of animals, had already had their evolutionary development. But flowering plants, birds, mammals, they are later evolutionary developments. They flowered only after India joined Asia. So much of our components of birds, mammals, and then I can stand. So many of our birds, mammals, flowering plants, we derive from Asia. There isn't something particularly special as far as India is concerned. We share them with many other countries, but especially the amphibians and reptiles, the frogs and their relatives, and lizards and snakes and their relatives, they had started evolving well when we were still part of this southern continent. And their evolution continued while Indian landmass was making its way across the oceans, resulting in the fact that we have a large number of species which are particularly confined to India, and especially the Western Ghats, because as I said, Eastern Himalayas are formed, of course, after the landmass joined Asia, and many of the species are therefore derived from other countries. The result, of course, therefore, is that these two particular groups, the snakes and the amphibians, are especially restricted to Western Ghats. And indeed, if we talk about, as I said, as per the Convention on Biological Diversity, of groups of plants, animals, for which India is the country of origin, then Western Ghats and these groups particularly stand out. I will quickly show some pictures of species which are on the Western Ghats and which are specific to India. This is a tree frog. This is a limbless relative of frogs. Birds, there are relatively few which are endemic and restricted to us, but this black and rufous flycatcher is one of them. The lion-tailed macaque, one of the monkey species. The Nilgiri tar, a wild goat. And amongst the flowering plants, this group called balsams, or terada in Marathi, these are very colorful flowering herbs. They are abundant in the Western Ghats. The Western Ghats are also importantly the major source of water for peninsular India, for both the West Coast and the Southern Peninsula. This is the area, the forested area at the origin of River Kaveri, which is of course one of the most important rivers of peninsular India. And as you will see, the area of origin had been traditionally protected, continues to be protected as sacred site with a sacred, large sacred forest. Bhima is one of our tributary of Krishna, is one of our major rivers. And again, just like the Kaveri, we saw Talakaveri, similarly, the area where the point where Bhima originates, called Gupta Bhima in the hills north of Pune, is a large sacred grove, traditionally protected again by the communities over perhaps thousands of years as far as I know. And indeed, I want to stress that there is a rich tradition of veneration of nature and its careful, sustainable use in India. And we certainly must make take advantage of this tradition. But tradition is one thing. And importantly, in modern age, what is important is understanding the context and thinking, working out strategies of development, which can at the same time safeguard this important heritage. Now, therefore, I think one of the major priorities should be to ground our economic development so that it will become sustainable in sound scientific information. Now, one of, I think, the serious problems in our currently, certainly I believe, a highly defective system of governance is that it ignores, even suppresses good information. This is just one example. The government of India itself, some 10 years ago, undertook an exercise called Zonal Atlas for Siting of Industries. For most of the districts of the country, the idea was that there will be a mapping on a spatial base where the existing pollution loads are, and to see where the pollution has reached its limits, there should not be further pollution added there, and where there are possibilities that with care you can have additional industries which might pollute. So this atlas, and indeed the preface to the whole exercise says that this atlas will be an important tool for the industry also. So they don't waste proposing projects in areas where then there will be objections that there are issues of pollution, you cannot cite these industries. There should be clear guidelines where certain kinds of industries can come, where they cannot come. And in our large amounts of money were spent, a lot of people worked on it, and the atlas was produced, after which, regrettably, it was suppressed. The Ministry of Environment, which had sponsored it, its own secretary, decreed that it should be suppressed, it should not be made available.
Which year was this?
This is in... I will check. I mean, I know, but it has escaped me. Something like 10 years ago. The gentleman who suppressed it was, I think, 7 years ago, the secretary, so it must have been about that. I didn't want to name him, but I know him very well. In any case, now the point is that even our panel, now when our panel started its work, what we were expected to do indeed is to look at the available information, scientific information relating to Western Ghats, and in that context talk about what kind of development should be encouraged. So we asked the government, what are the databases? I mean, of course, we had some idea ourselves. We have been working in this area. But what are the databases with the government which we should be using for this purpose? Nobody mentioned this database, though it is very relevant. Much of Western Ghats is covered in this database. So at least some part of our information we needed is already available, properly, spatially organized in this database. Fortunately, we have things like right to information, and fortunately, we have officers whose cousins are growing mango orchards in Ratnagiri, and there is a really serious threat of whole sorts of air pollution to the mango orchards. So one of them told me, no, such a database exists. I have heard of it. So we requested the ministry that all the Western Ghats districts databases may please be made available to us. They did not readily agree. Finally, after much effort, Ratnagiri district database we could access. And the gentleman here in Bombay, who had worked on this for 2.5 years preparing the database, came to me with this whole material, said he is delighted that his 2.5 years labor, at least somebody will see. Otherwise, he was feeling very frustrated that he had done all this and it was simply being kept under wraps. So, if we are going to have proper sustainable development based in good information, this kind of approach simply will not do. And this is our first point. Secondly, I mean, we have a whole lot of laws, environmental protection laws, which are often very well designed, and their purpose is indeed to have proper economic activities in conjunction with environmental protection. But they are simply not implemented. And the one of the worst cases is that of the Maharashtra Industrial Development Corporation's chemical industry hub at Lote, near Chipalur in Ratnagiri district. So I did, as part of our panel's work, a specific case study, visited, talked to people, saw myself. There is a common effluent treatment plant, and admittedly, according to everybody, it does not work. It can take care of very little of the pollution. Most of it is getting out. It is poisoning the springs around. It is poisoning in particular Vashishti River and the Dabol Creek. There are large-scale fish kills. The fishing community claims that as a result, the amount of unemployment it has created in fishing community is greatly exceeds the number of jobs the industry has created. There are no official estimates of how many fishermen have become jobless. They say 20,000. I checked what is the official figure of people employed in the industrial complex. It is 11,000. Anyway, then all sorts of things get done. At night, one night, a tanker full of very serious polluting whatever waste was dumped into a reservoir which supplies water regularly to Khed town. So for 3 weeks, Khed town had no water supply. They were desperately trying to get back the water supply resumed after this poisoning. Then the local people have found information and they have given names of industries which are not only the surface pollution, but which have dug bore wells to inject the polluted toxic waste into groundwater. This is happening. They gave me the names also. They said they have submitted these names to the pollution control board. Again and again, no action has been taken. There is a local committee which is supposed to be monitoring what is going on with local panchayat members and other citizens. In Mantralaya here only, very close by, I had a meeting, a three-hour meeting with Maharashtra government officials before I went to Ratnagiri to discuss what we should be doing. They told that, yes, there is a committee at this Lote complex. It is very active. We are taking their input, so everything is being taken good care of. I go there. The committee members came with great joy again, like this official who had prepared this dhasi for Ratnagiri. They said after 2 years and some months, for the first time a meeting has been called because you are here. And many of our recommendations, including, as I was telling you about this poisoning of great water, which was part of the recommendations of the earlier committee meeting, have not been completely ignored. So as a result, what has the Pollution Control Board done, because there are all these protests, very legitimate protests. They had an office at Lotte at the MIDC complex where people could come and point things out. So they have moved it to Chipulun, so it's 40 kilometers away. People cannot readily get hold of them. And I got these figures out of Ratnagiri District Collector's office on 180 days in 600 days prior to my visit a year and a half ago. There were protests, I think very legitimate and peaceful protests against pollution. On 180 days, the collector declared some Maharashtra Police Act 35 and suppressed those protests. So not only is the act not being implemented, but citizens' very legitimate information provided to government is not being acted on, and their legitimate protests are being suppressed. And of course, suppressing scientific information, there is an enormous amount of it going on. This zonal atlas is a more striking example. Our report was another example of this kind of an approach. So what did we do? There was a committee chaired by Pranab Sen, who was, I think, an official of with the Planning Commission. In India, after the 1986 Environmental Protection Act, many initiatives were taken to protect the environment using that act. One of them was to constitute some areas as ecologically sensitive areas. Dahanu Taluka is one well-known example. Justice Dharmadhikari is the chairman of Dahanu Taluka Ecology Authority. It is one particular context where I think there is some very good action being taken on the ground. But that has happened only because of continuous interference by courts. There are other areas which have also been declared in this fashion, Matheran and Mahabaleshwar and Murud Janjira in Maharashtra, where hardly any proper activity is happening because the courts are not continually monitoring what is happening. Only in Dahanu this is happening. Anyway, now these Murud, Mahabaleshwar, Matheran and Dahanu were constituted in an ad hoc fashion. So people said there must be some by a proper scientific basis. Government set up this committee under Sen's chairmanship to suggest the scientific basis for constituting or considering areas as ecologically sensitive. The committee submitted its report in 2000, and it said that they are suggesting certain criteria, but there is very little information. And immediately, a major all-India effort should be launched to put together all this information. We started working in March 2010. Between 2000, when Sen committee said there should be this information base created, to 2010, no action was taken. So our panel, for the first time, took up from where Sen committee had suggested a series of criteria, and we said for at least Western Ghats, let us try to put together this database. But now then, the ecological sensitivity and so on are not any standard, well-defined concepts. We had to do further work. We put in a fair amount of scientific effort, as a result of which we published a paper in our India's leading science journal, Current Science, also asking for people's feedback. And based on all this, we decided on how to set about this whole exercise. So our major mandate was, in fact, to look at ecological sensitivity of different parts of Western Ghats and make specific suggestions. I will not go perhaps into details into the kind of data sets we managed to put together. We could, for the present, use only computerized data sets because there is a lot additional information, for example, with Bombay Natural History Society, which is not readily computerized, which we could not use within our short tenure, but all that really ought to be done. I will not belabor these technical points. So we had some very good people who are interested in computerized information systems working with us. We had to do a certain amount of data cleaning. Then, since particular regions have to be given a specific value, certain grouping, averaging exercises, and ranking the parameters. So on all this basis, what we have done, I think, is developed a kind of an algorithm, a procedure for assigning ecological sensitivity to different parts of Western Ghats. Now, if you take the SANE committee criteria, they have proposed 14 criteria, then every square meter of Western Ghat meets maybe at 10 out of these 14 criteria. So in that sense, by a committee's criteria accepted by the ministry in 2000, the entire Western Ghat must be considered ecologically sensitive. But obviously, you cannot have a kind of a uniform kind of protection regime and a rigid protection regime for this vast region. So we had to try to see relatively what are areas which are more sensitive, less sensitive, and then arrive at some set of suggestions, which is what we have done, which is available, open to everybody. And right from the beginning, we did this exercise in a kind of transparent fashion. As we did the analysis, we uploaded it on the web. We got a lot of input responses. And I think I'm confident in saying that we have a first ever for India knowledge-based environmental decision support system. Using that, of course, lot more work ought to be done. But this is the only part of India for which this has actually been attempted. We have to then use these kind of systems to make proper decisions on how to initiate a whole range of development activities in an environmentally sustainable fashion. This is what has been done, following which, of course, immediately, as I said, the government suppressed the report, which actually was kind of surprising to me, because just before we finally submitted the report, we had a long, detailed meeting with the then minister and all the senior officials of the ministry. Everything which is in the report was discussed with them. They gave some suggestions also. They were incorporated. So there could have been absolutely no surprise to the ministry people as to what was in the report. And throughout our work, we had been interacting with them. Anyway, so they made the decision to suppress it. And finally, after some 8-9 months, because of the intervention of the Chief Information Commissioner first, and then Delhi High Court, this was made public. Just a sample of what the Chief Information Commissioner had to say, these reports government may or may not accept, nevertheless, they are an important basis for citizens also to understand what should be done, and in a scientific, reasonable manner, citizens would be in a position to articulate their concerns if this information is available. And government can certainly decide not to act on it, but they should logically put before the people what are the reasons. Otherwise, citizens would believe that government decisions are arbitrary or corrupt. And he goes on to say more or less the same thing. Ministry's unwillingness to be transparent is likely to give the citizens an impression that most decisions are taken in furtherance of corruption, resulting in a serious trust deficit. I have not quoted the immediately after the Information Commissioner's verdict, ministry rushed to Delhi High Court, which made even more stringent remarks. I have not quoted them, but anyway. And then the ministry agreed to release it. When the Delhi High Court said, you have to release it, they did it. Now, what I would like to submit, we have, as part of the work of the panel, seen that basically the development decisions are taken, are thrust upon people without their being consulted, being involved in any way. And also the decisions about nature conservation efforts, they are also thrust on people. And regrettably, the forestry establishment which is in charge of nature conservation is the perhaps the one ministry of the government of India which even today officially says people are our enemies. The other ministries may or may not treat them well, but they never say officially people are their enemies. The foresters officially say people are our enemies. Just to say what happens, how decisions are made against all reasonable arguments. Atirappalli is a hydroelectric project in Kerala. Now, fortunately, because of the Right to Information Act, a very competent group of engineers from Kerala who are concerned about these issues, called River Research Foundation, they accessed the full detailed project report of the Atirappalli project. They did serious scientific work themselves, including some simulations to check through much of the design. They have shown that there isn't enough water to generate the kind of electricity the project claims it will generate. There is a lot of downstream of where the dam will come up, irrigation from Chalkudi River, that is going to be disrupted. There is a major waterfall where the dam is to come, and that waterfall will dry up. It's a major tourism and a pilgrimage center that will be disrupted. And from an ecological point of view, we have some examples of the forests in the hills which are intact and well preserved, but this is a low elevation river bank forest. This is one of the last examples which are remaining that will be destroyed. Now, and of course, it is the abode of Kadars, who are a primitive tribe. Their rights under Forest Rights Act have not been implemented, which is also a violation of the law. Point is, we had a public open meeting where the River Research Foundation engineers made all these points through a proper, well-documented presentation. We had specially invited, and the Kerala government's engineers who have proposed the project, a lot of them were present. We requested them, after the River Research Foundation made their points, to rebut them. They had absolutely nothing to rebut. In a sense, they accepted all these claims. All they came up with is a petition from the Kerala Electricity Board's labor union that we want this project. Fine. But the engineers cannot rebut any of the technical points. It is only the labor union which is saying we want this project, as against which we had public meetings in the area nearby. And as I said, the destruction of irrigation, of the tourism, there is a huge local opposition to the project. So scientifically, it is simply not defendable, and all sorts of things are going on. The other, just a counter example of what is not being paid attention to, is this very interesting case of the Plachimada Panchayat. This is part of Palakkad district in Kerala. There is a Coca-Cola factory there, and the use of water by Coca-Cola factory has dried up the farmers' wells. So the Panchayat pressed the point, and government of Kerala appointed an official committee of technically well-qualified engineers to look into this issue. They reported that, yes, the claims of the Panchayat that there was very serious depletion of the groundwater because of the factory are valid, and they, I think, valued the loss at something like 200 crores, or it's an enormous sum. And this was a very clear-cut suggestion, submission of this technical panel. So the Kerala legislature, with support from all parties, I guess maybe unanimously, said that the factory must compensate the farmers, Plachimada farmers. The bill has been passed by Kerala Assembly. The President of India is keeping it without signing it. So now I think I will quickly close. Just to show another case, where the people supposedly responsible for nature conservation, how they are unfortunately cannot deliver the goods as far as conserving nature is concerned. This is a case study of a windmill project north of Pune, south of where I earlier showed you this Bhima's source, Gupta Bhima, around which now a Bhima Shankar wildlife sanctuary has been created. Maharashtra's state animal is this giant squirrel, and this area is very rich. Here is the geographically. As I mentioned, Mahabaleshwar has been constituted as an ecologically sensitive area because of its important evergreen forest. This is the last northernmost stretch of evergreen forest here. This is where Shingi is the peak near Bhima's origin. So this is the area where now the windmills are coming up. In 2002, the Indian Board of Wildlife had recommended that for 10 kilometers around the protected areas, including of course the Bhima Shankar Sanctuary, ecologically sensitive zones might be constituted after examination on the ground. It is very clear that this region, because of its importance in terms of biodiversity, would have qualified, and such a ecologically sensitive zone ought to have been constituted. But between 2002, after that, no action was taken. Despite in 2005, Maharashtra High Court asking the Forest Department to take action. Still, they did not take action. Just to mention the rich biodiversity of this tract, this is the perhaps only insect in the world which has been at least properly documented, which has color vision in the dark. It's a kind of a bumblebee. And this is a special habitat of this bumblebee, is the area which is disturbed. Now, just some images. You can see that there are these major reservoirs, and this is the yellows are where the windmills are coming up. They are coming up on the hill of the crest from where the catchments are. Now, when in 2008, the proposal for the windmills went to the range forest officer for his comments, he honestly made these comments that indeed this is an area very rich in biodiversity, and he feels that permission should not be granted for the windmills. Immediately thereafter, I think 3 weeks later, his boss, conservator of forest, made a fraudulent report. It simply says that the project area does not have any significant wildlife. In particular, I specially went and at a village called Kharpur, where there is a primary school. I spent sleeping in that primary school for 4 nights and going around. It is genuinely abundant with not just giant squirrel, but a whole lot of other important wildlife species. He says it is bushy growth more than trees. You can see some of his so-called bushy growth. This is as good as Mahabaleshwar, where the windmills have come up. And this is the kind of roads that are being constructed. These roads are being constructed. This is just some photographs of the giant squirrel nest in the project area. This is with the complete neglect of any kind of worry about landslides, about erosion, and so on. Mr. Deshpande, who retired as Secretary PWD from Government of Maharashtra, he had spent his whole life constructing roads. I took him to see these roads. He was livid with anger. He said, all these people have thought of is to construct roads so the windmills are the crest of the hills. So up the hills at unacceptably high gradients, with as little cost as possible. They have no other consideration. And you can see there is a huge amount of damage, lot of there is a government constituted medicinal plant conservation area in the same region which is now affected by these. Lot of fields are being affected, and these are these two dams on Bhama and Arla river which are getting silted up. Then the conditions for clearance to the windmill says that free movement of local villagers should not be prohibited, but this is supposedly Forest Department's board, but it is actually the company's board. The Forest Department is colluding with them. They have taken clearance for just the few hectares on top of the hill for windmills, but they have captured whole hills and they are controlling them and not allowing people who have these dhangars have had their wadas for centuries. They are now restricting them. So the, there are all sorts of other, they have fraudulently given Gram Sabha resolutions. Gram Sabhas had not agreed to the project. They have submitted to the government fraudulent documents showing Gram Sabhas have agreed to the project. So there are all sorts of these things also. Now, we from our panel, I requested Forest Department again and again to give me the relevant documentation. They finally, at a public meeting in Pune, the chief conservator declared that they have lost all documents. But luckily, under RTI, they cannot declare they have lost all documents. So one of the local villagers has got hold of them, so we got all of the information. So this is unfortunately the case. And Forest Department is unfortunately getting from bad to worse, that they will not allow anybody to have access to forest areas, wildlife areas, because people are saying, seeing all sorts of things which they should not be doing, which they are doing. I tried earlier in my career to work in the wildlife areas, then I, out of frustration, gave up because of the harassment. But the harassment was then limited. This is in the 70s. Now recently, two of our research students were actually arrested and put in jail on the flimsiest of the charges. So this is the problem. I think, as I started saying, Kalidasa thinks of this mountain range as a maiden. So I have given her name Sayachala. So what is happening is that Sayachala's green sari is being now stripped off by modern day Dushyasana. Of course, you know, the meaning of the word Dushyasana is bad governance. And this is, I think, our serious problem. We need a, I think, Bhima of Loka Shakti to correct this. This is, and well, the other issue which has come up and has been widely talked about is this so-called UNESCO heritage sites. There are some 39 such sites which have been given by, through Government of India's advocacy, protection as natural world, natural heritage sites. But these are just a few percent of the Western Ghats. So you cannot really try to protect on a long-term basis biodiversity in such small areas. We have to have not at all national parks and wildlife sanctuaries covering the entire Western Ghats, but outside them, proper, well taken care for environment and biodiversity friendly ambiences which can be created. Even Indian Institute of Science campus, which is in the middle of Bangalore city now, we have managed, because of the interest of the director, to have a small forest in the middle of the campus where loris, slender loris, which is one of the threatened species, a healthy population of slender loris exists. So we can create such habitats throughout, and this is what we must do. Then of course the current conservation efforts are focusing only on forest areas. We need to, especially the aquatic biodiversity, there are a whole lot of plateaus, grasslands, which also need to be safeguarded. And our kind of set of guidelines is trying to propose guidelines to make sure that the entire region is protected carefully, but development is allowed to go on in a planned rational fashion. And what we then suggest also is that clearly we do not have both the possible detailed information nor the time to work these things out in detail. So the report suggests that please now make this report available to all the people on the Western Ghats in Marathi, Konkani, Kannada, Tamil, Malayalam. Let them look at it. And there is an excellent precedent. A few years ago, Goa started preparing its regional plan, which is how much building activity and other things should come where. People protested against a plan government had prepared in its usual fashion, sitting in the Parvari Secretariat. So then they had another task force which prepared a careful database on the current levels of construction in Goa, superimposed on Google Earth imagery, and they made their own suggestions. The government then took the very good step of giving all this information to every Gram Sabha, every Ward Sabha in Goa. And all the Gram Sabhas, Ward Sabhas have come back with their suggestion, and now that is being used to finalize the development plan. So it has been done in Goa. What we suggested that this is what should be done with our report. And Goa's, of course, that task force report was made available not only in English but Marathi and Konkani to people of Goa. Similar fashion, all the relevant languages from Gujarati to Malayalam. We should have the report made available. Let it go to the people. Let them examine. Let them say if they want something different. And in particular, let them work out in detail what they want. And when we made such an appeal, we got some very interesting response. A cluster of 25 Gram Sabhas in Sindhudurg district, in fact, all the 25 Gram Sabhas passed a resolution. They want their region to be properly cared for through some appropriate ecologically sensitive classification. And I requested them, they came up with their own development plans, which are for them environment friendly development plans for each of the village. I think this is really the route we should go, because I am convinced that it is that we certainly still have in amongst our people, in our culture at the grassroots, both respect for nature, environment, and a number of good traditions. What we need from the top is good governance and people's involvement in making appropriate decisions. So I think the next step which we are requesting is that people should get involved in asking that, not that our report should be accepted in toto in any sense, but be involved in promoting a people-oriented democratic process of decision-making using our report as a base. Because this information, I think, is very relevant. Let it be used as a base, made available in all our languages, and then we progress. But in any case, I think what we should be thinking of is that we must have proper enforcement of laws. There is a whole lot of provisions which are already in place which would allow us to protect our environment while certainly permitting economic development. But I will close just with one example. There is a whole lot of details which I can leave with you of what laws already are available, what framework is already available for involving people, which is simply not being evoked. The kind of development pattern is typically illustrated by one coal-based power project in Ratnagiri district. They have, I understand, imported at very low expense machinery discarded from Europe because it is highly polluting. You cannot use it in Europe. And it is set up on Konkan coast because in Konkan you can exceed the pollution levels, legal pollution levels, many folds, and nobody is going to bother you. The they now have further, they can save costs by importing coal from abroad. That coal comes by ships. So they are using estuaries, and they have set up ports in the estuaries to take coal for their thermal power plant. That same estuary had a government-sanctioned fishing port. The fishing port was being constructed. The factory, this power plant people went to High Court, stopped construction of that fishing port. They have by force taken over the estuary. The fishing community is in serious problem. They had invited me to visit. I went and I talked to them. They showed me their corporate social responsibility program, which involves tailoring classes for women. So I later went to the fishing villages there and talked to them. And the fishermen, as you know, we are in Maharashtra all fond of them. So they are very vocal also. They said, look, they are stopping us fishing. We don't want to become tailor women. We want to sell fish. This is what we enjoy. And we want to eat those fish. So this is, I think, the kind of development which we should not allow. We have to think about how to reorient this whole pattern. And I think certainly an important component will have to be that people have to be empowered by actually implementing a large number of laws which exist. Just one example, there is a Biological Diversity Act which says that every panchayat should have a biodiversity management committee, which has actually number of powers also granted under the act. Now, if that act is actually implemented in the country, local communities have very good scope for participating in a meaningful fashion in protecting the biodiversity and actually all the other natural assets. It's a 2002 law. Even in 2012, it is hardly being implemented in any part of the country. So even if we actually implement all our environmental laws, including these laws, and actually give people their proper role which the Constitution and the laws provide, we can make tremendous progress. And this should be done everywhere in the country. Apart from that, I think we must, we are so proud of our scientific technical achievement, we must ground our efforts in good science, good information, and as we have attempted to do here, take all this forward and create a proper, both scientifically sound and people-oriented base for development. Thank you very much.